Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. E ngā manuhiri e aku huamahi, kua huihui mai nei ngā mihi nui ki a koutou katoa. Ko tēnei taku mihi ki ngā tangata whenua o te rohe nei, ka mihi hoki au ki ngā tohu o te rohe nei. Nō reira, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Ko wai au. Nō Ingarangi oku tupuna, nō kirikiri roa oku matua, e tipu ake, ake au ki Kemureti, ki Ototahi, ki Ahureri, ki Ingarangi, me ki Tāmaki makaurau. E noho ana ki Sandringham, e noho ana au ki Sandringham. E mahi ana au he, hei paukokiri ki Tāmaki Pātaka Kōrero, ko Renée Orr tōku ingoa. Who am I? My ancestors are from England, largely. The first of my ancestors to arrive in Aotearoa came in 1859. My parents are from Hamilton. I grew up in Cambridge, Christchurch, Napier, England, and in Auckland. I live in Sandringham. I work as a senior librarian here at the Central City Library. To my talk today, I'm going to be talking about creating a family history book for your kids or your grandkids. My talk is based on my own personal experience, because of course that is what our family history is to us, it's personal. Family stories have meaning and interest for us because they inform that question, ko wai o, who am I? So keep in mind that there's no one way to do this. What I will try to share is the thinking that I've done, the resources that I found, and the way I've gone about it. So, speaking personally, there's an example on the screen. I've used this crayon and dye picture made by my son as inspiration when thinking about our ancestors. The arcs of the rainbow encircle us, getting wider as they move out like ripples in the past. Your inspiration and the way you go about it will be based on what's appropriate for you and your whānau. However, just because it's personal to us doesn't mean we can't share it, especially with our kids and our grandkids. In fact, I think we should. So this is going to be my first question. Why do this? Next, I'll look at some things to think about when you're setting out. What am I making? And some things to think about here are things like the age of your grandkids, whether you have a blended family or family members who were adopted, two mums or two dads. How will you share what you make? And finally, how do you make it? So, do you want to use fancy software or publishing programs, or paper and scissors and glue, or maybe a mix of the two? So, why do this? When I started thinking about this, I came up with quite a few reasons. Some of them may resonate with you, and some of them may not. First up, researching your family history is fun, but it can mean sitting at a computer all day. I've done quite a bit of this, and sometimes I've felt like there's not much to show for all those hours. So thinking about an end product, creating something, can give your research a shape and a purpose. Creating something gives you a way to share your knowledge and connect with your family at the same time. Creating, sharing, connecting, these things are all really good for our mental health. This photo is from my mother-in-law's family. It's her grandfather in the middle, and I love it so much. We don't know where they are, why they're dressed up, or what the occasion is, but it's awesome. So using fun stuff like this is a good idea. Hearing family stories is good for children too. Professor Elaine Reese works in the psychology department at the University of Otago. She researches the role that stories play in the learning and well-being of children and teenagers. So she wrote this book, Tell Me a Story, for parents about family storytelling, by which she means sharing stories either by reading or in conversation. Elaine argues that family storytelling helps children develop language, emotional awareness and coping skills, and their sense of belonging. It's a really practical book based on research with New Zealand families, with tips for sharing stories with children at all different ages, from toddlers through to adolescents. She also considers cultural differences in the way that families tell and use stories. And the library has several copies you can reserve and borrow. I'm going to refer to a few books in the talk, and I'm mostly putting the references on the slide. Elaine is also co-author of an academic article about family secrets, very interesting topic, which looked specifically at teenagers and their knowledge of family stories which are told through silences or not openly discussed. The article discusses the difference between accessing family documents on genealogical websites versus the experience of being engaged in family storytelling. Family storytelling, as you might expect, builds relationship and intimacy. I thought this was so relevant to the idea of creating a family history book that it was worth reading a whole quote. So, without these fleshed out stories that bring specific facts to life, they are merely words on paper and cannot carry the immediacy or intimacy of a personal story in ways that connect individuals across the generations. These stories provide maps to understanding how the world does work and how it should work and express core values and ideals. Family stories are not just about preserving history, but about creating family futures that honour what the family has experienced. In the article, the authors found that teenagers who know more about their intergenerational past have higher levels of well-being and a greater sense of meaning and purpose in their lives. And the stories told aren't necessarily about positive experiences. In fact, difficult and challenging experiences can provide a basis for stories of resilience and strength. And that leads us to a rather big topic. So family history is also part of a bigger picture, and that's the colonial history of Aotearoa New Zealand. Researching your family history connects you personally, intergenerationally, to that big picture. And speaking as a Pākehā person, I believe we need to know how our families benefited from the processes of colonisation in the past so that we can understand our privilege in the present. We need this knowledge and our children need this knowledge so that we can begin to end racism in this country. These are two pieces of writing that I found quite useful on this topic about Pākehā privilege, and they both contain personal reflections about family history. And the one on the left, Leah Bell, is a history student. She describes the experience of discovering that an ancestor had participated in a violent attack against Māori during the New Zealand Wars. Jen Margaret, a treaty educator, describes learning more about how one of her ancestors acquired a piece of land. These two pieces resonated with me because I've had a similar experience when researching my own ancestors. I'll just really briefly talk about that. So, starting with this map, a map from our collection. It's a survey map showing allotments along the Waikato River near Cambridge in the Cambridge and Tamahere highway districts. It was made in 1880, just 17 years after the invasion of the Waikato and the subsequent confiscation of this land. In 1880, negotiations were ongoing between the Kingitanga and the settler government regarding these unjust confiscations, with Waikato Māori seeking the return of their land and trying to prevent further alienation through the native land courts. So in 1880, my great-great-grandfather Samuel Carling was farming 200 acres at Hotapu, and that's just above the big M of Cambridge there, having emigrated to Aotearoa from Cornwall in 1878. I'm still researching this family story because it wasn't a story that was told to me, but there are a few things that are clear. Ngāti Koroki Kahukura and Ngāti Haua are mana whenua of the wider Cambridge area. Following the invasion of the Waikato, Ngāti Koroki Kahukura lands were confiscated and distributed to military settlers. These lands were drained for dairy purposes to supply the Hotapu dairy factory. And this is the Hotapu dairy factory in 1905. It's 1 year before my great-grandfather, William Yates Kirkman, a recent immigrant from England, married Samuel Cowling's daughter, Charity. William went on to have a successful career in the dairy industry, rising to a senior role in the New Zealand Cooperative Dairy Company, travelling overseas for work. My great-grandparents lived in a nice house in Hamilton. So when I looked at my family history, it wasn't hard to see the Pākehā privilege woven in. And this is Hotapu today. Remembering what Elaine and her co-authors said about difficult and challenging experiences providing a basis for stories of resilience and strength, we know that these things, social justice, history, identity, are important to our kids and our teenagers. You might recognise this photograph or the occasion shown here. Taken in 2015, it shows a group of Aotearoa college students tied to Araki Jones, Waimarama Anderson, Leah Bell, she's the author of the Itangata article, and Rhiannon McGee and their supporters delivering a 13,000 signature petition to Parliament calling for a National Day of Commemoration for those killed in the New Zealand Wars. And they were successful. He Rā Mau Maraha is now an annual day of commemoration held on 28th of October. They also called for the compulsory teaching of New Zealand history in schools. That wasn't accepted at the time, but last year Jacinda Ardern announced that from 2022 this will happen too. When making the announcement, the Prime Minister said the government had listened carefully to the growing calls from New Zealanders to know more about our own history and identity. So I think that what we can do with our interest in family history research is to give our kids a head start with the history learning that they will do at school. We can make it personal for them, we can bring those facts to life, and we can express the ideals and values that we would like to see our kids carry into the future. And that's the lofty bit of the talk. I'll get to the bookmaking now. So onto the practical things to think about when you're starting out. The first thing to decide is, what am I making? So this is about defining your scope. Some questions to think about. What are you aiming to achieve and who for? It's quite tempting to be making something for yourself, even though you're thinking about making it for your children. How old are your kids or grandkids? So what you make needs to be suitable for their attention spans and their interests. What will you include or exclude? After all, you do have thousands of ancestors. You might want to focus on one family line or one person even, or go big and try to include it all. For me, it was about who are my ancestors who migrated to Aotearoa? Where do they come from? Where did they settle? Even that turned out to be quite large, to be honest, despite me thinking that I could create one book for each grandparent that included all their immigrant ancestors. What I found was that there were actually too many people. There wasn't enough room to tell enough stories and enough detail. It just wasn't really engaging. So it was back to the drawing board on scope for my project. What does your family look like? As I said before, do you have a blended family or adopted family members or two mums or two dads? And this kind of leads us into the area of genealogy versus family history. So genealogy being the bit where you trace descent and you probably have a chart that shows the connections between generations. Family history includes that, of course, but it also brings in the stories and the lived experiences of our ancestors. And seeing it from a child's perspective, family is family. My children have three granddads and three nanas. They're all important to my kids, and I want my kids to know all their family stories, not just those that they're descended from. After all, we inherit more than just our genetics. So considering these things, I went looking for genealogy charts that might allow some flexibility. This is a beautiful example. This whakapapa chart is the centerpiece in a beautiful research guide created by my colleagues here at Auckland Libraries. It puts the person, aho, at the center of expanding circles of generations. And I also made this version where there are no boxes at all. It's a bit low tech because my design skills are a bit limited, but the idea is that the child is at the center. I talked about it before, it's the rainbow. The colors might help identify which generation family members belong to. And basically it's a background for creating your own freehand drawn chart. And there's lots of scope for including your kids or grandkids as well. I also look more generally at how to make family history accessible and interesting for kids. One resource I found is a book written by Vicky Korn-Nagemeyer called Kids and Family History, Fun Ways to Spark Their Interest. Library's got several copies. She makes some general points that I think are worth keeping in mind. Children love to play, so make it as fun as you can. Children love stories. I discussed earlier the importance of stories, and Vicky emphasises this as well. So your stories need hooks, something that will make them memorable. Quirky anecdotes or photographs are great. Another idea is to look for things that kids can connect with their own lives now. For instance, we spend a lot of time at the kids' nana's house in Grey Lynn, and when I was looking to make a book about her family, I discovered that a lot of her ancestors had lived in different houses in the streets surrounding. Since the kids knew the streets, it sort of made sense to make a map that would show where all the houses where an ancestor had lived. Finally, kids love to make things, so you could plan to involve your child or grandchild in the actual creating, whether it's a book or an artwork or whatever you decide. I incorporated this idea by deciding to include a page where my kids could write or draw about themselves. So they're in the book too. In fact, it's their book. This is the book itself. It's not particularly exciting, like there's not many pictures, but it does have some really solid and practical ideas, and from different ages, from preschoolers to teens. She's got a really cool idea for preschoolers that I think would be fun and easy, which is to make an ABC book. So just created specifically for one child. It could include photographs of the child, other family members, keepsakes, places. I think it's a really easy structure. It allows for creativity and lots of content. She said that each page had at least one photo, some identifying text, and a bit of a story. She also suggests creating an Instagram account to connect with teenagers. I think that could be quite fun. I recommend it. You may not like all the suggestions, but they'll help you think of other ideas as well. So thinking about creativity, here are some cool projects made by children from Kadima School this year as part of their Roots project. These photos are all shared with permission of the principal, pupils and parents of Kadima School. And the ones that stood out to me were the ones where kids have included some sad, scary or difficult stories from their family's past. So about this person's great grandma. She was a survivor of the Japanese occupation. She survived by hiding in the basement of her house. The three missiles aimed at the house represent the 3 years of the occupation of Malaysia by the Japanese. This is part of a wider display. This one includes a couple of very interesting family stories involving weapons. Two stories of weapons in different colonised countries, New Zealand and India. I feel like there's a lot more to these stories, but the awesome thing is that they're memorable, and from the point of view of the young person who's made this, they will find out more about these stories as they get older. I love this one, particularly for the creative use of pipe cleaners, to show the family journeys to Aotearoa, and also a really flexible way of doing a family tree, again with the pipe cleaners. And I think that's also like a head and shoulders silhouette, perhaps of that person's head. Another beautiful family tree, and using a fan to record family details and represent culture is a brilliant idea as well. These are the kind of projects that our kids might well be doing in school as part of their history core curriculum learning. We can give them a head start by giving them some information to start with. If you think you'd like to involve your kids or grandkids in doing a creative family history project, you might want to have some conversations with them first. A good way to start these conversations is with books. These ones here are mostly picture books. For a wide range of ages. Most are available for borrowing, but a couple we only have as reference copies at Research Central in the Family History Collection. In the top right, Me and My Family Tree is a nice introduction to the concepts. It's very child-centred, about kind of what different family members mean to the person. You can also get it as an ebook through the Libby app. Very handy. Mihi by Gavin Bishop is a beautiful book. It's a new book. It's a board book, so it's suitable for babies. It introduces to our Māori concepts of mihi mihi and pepeha, showing the connections between waka, mountain, iwi, through to mama, papa and baby. So it's a great one for Christmas. The others, Who Am I, Be a Family Tree Detective, and the kids' family tree book. Kind of more aimed at encouraging kids to research their family history themselves. So these are probably a bit more suitable for older tamariki, but it will be good if your kids or grandkids are really interested and want to start researching themselves. Typically they start with, go and interview your grandmother. It's always a good thing to do. A slightly different approach is to write family history stories as if they were fiction. So Hazel Edwards is an Australian author best known for this children's classic. There's a hippopotamus on the hospital roof eating cake. This was a more interesting picture to include than the picture that came with the article. She teaches writing, and specifically family history writing. She has a book called Learn How to Write a Non-Boring Family History. This is a worthy goal. A very kind colleague gave me an article that Hazel wrote for Traces magazine. That's an Australian family history magazine. You can get it through the from the library, and also as an e-magazine through RB Digital. So she encourages people to write their own stories as fiction. And she says that many children may not be interested in reading family stories now, but they may be later. Unless you record the stories, they will be lost as your memories fade or as you run out of energy. So if you enjoy children's books and writing, this would be a really cool thing to do. And if you're perhaps wanting to write a longer version of your story, then this could be a good way to start as well. So in the article, she gives 20 top tips for turning your family history into an engaging story for the children in your family. So consider your audience, who's going to read this. If you're writing for a specific child, you'll know what they're interested in. You know, like they might be interested in trains, so write about that. Choose one incident to feature in your story. So stories have a dramatic occurrence. Keep it simple and focused on the story. You can always write several stories that include all the things that happened to you in your life, but if you're writing an engaging story, just do one thing. Talk about what went wrong, bad times, as well as fun times, and details. So what work did people do? With what tools? Maybe they lived in a house where the toilet was in the garden. Those sorts of things are quite different. So I've talked a little bit about how to make it, creative approaches, but if you really want to make a book, then there's a few things that you could try. So you could use some fancy software and do it on the computer. If you have graphic design skills or graphic design software, then you're sorted already. If not, Microsoft Publisher has some templates for making A5 booklets, pretty reliable but pretty basic. You can print them and fold them or staple them yourself, or you can take them to a print shop and they'll put it on nice paper. Web-based photo book services, for example, Memento, offer free software. You download, you kind of use the layout options, and then you choose your binding. Bit more pricey, but you might get something that looks a little bit more professional and kind of lasts a long time. They've got themed templates, so that can either make it really easy to achieve a nice design layout or look really cheesy, depending on your aesthetic sensibility. Web-based design websites like Canva also offer templates and export as PDF options, so again, you then take it to the print shop. Or you can go handmade and use zine-making techniques with paper, scissors and glue. So zines are limited edition, self-published works, often made just using a photocopier. There's lots of ways to make a zine and lots of books and tutorials to show you how. One book we have in the library is called What You Mean, What's a Zine? Not all of the techniques will be suitable for a family history book, but you never know what might appeal to you and your kids. And these are kind of low-cost options that get us away from our computers, and they're creative and the kids can be involved as well. One easy way is to use the no staple or 8-page folded method. So I've got one I can show you that I made. I don't have any slides for this, by the way. So this is the 8-page theme, and I've made it on the back of a pedigree chart. So this is your genealogical chart, my daughter. It has all your family history on one family line, and it's also this story, the Book of Family Elizabeths, the rainbow. So we have my daughter's grandmother, her great-grandmother, a little bit about her great-great-grandmother. They all have Elizabeth in their name, so that's why it's the Book of Family Elizabeths. And a little bit about the great-great-great-grandmother, and then my daughter on the back. still a draft, but I think the Book of Family Elizabeths is my most successful attempt so far. It really showed me how little you have to include, really, to make it sort of engaging. If you are going to go handmade, there's a couple of things that I would recommend. First, make drafts. So you want to know that all your text is going to fit on the page before you start writing, and with an 8-page scene, that's not a lot of text. So it really encourages you to kind of focus in and think about what you really want to say. Keep mother copies. So you might want to make multiple copies of your book for different kids or grandkids or cousins. So for that book, it's really for my daughter, but for another book that was about her grandmother's family, all that you would need to do to make it relevant to all the other grandchildren would be to just leave that page blank where the child can write their own page about themselves. Everything else is relevant. So in terms of sharing the family history, you can really do a lot for all your nieces and nephews as well. It's always better to make multiple copies from one high quality original, so that's why I say keep a mother copy and then take copies from that as you need. You don't want to have to be handwriting all that stuff again too many times. And